Hi, I'm Kevin Honeycutt. I want to talk to you today about a lifelong love. When I was 4 years old, I made my first thing out of cardboard. I remember it distinctly. It was a Kraft macaroni and cheese box, and it took two of them to make dinner for the Honeycutt family. After we were done, I looked at this and I thought, well, if I cut it here and cut it here and remove the top and the back, but left the bottom and had a band across the top, I could slide my 4-year-old foot in there and make sandals. So I made a pair of sandals out of Kraft macaroni and cheese boxes. And my parents, I think, were amused. And I went on to just continue to create things. And now I grew up with this interesting combination of growing up in poverty, and that means I didn't get toys. Not very many anyway, and so I made a lot of my own stuff. And so part of Maker came from wanting to have things to play with. That was part of it. And just having this mind that's constantly thinking, what can this be? What is this thing I have in my hand asking to be this thing here? So here's this, and then here's this, right? And so we put these things together. Let's say these two things, this is on the bottom. Let's say I put this on top. So I have an angle there, and I have some drinking straws, and I put them here and here and here and here. What can I make? And so as I'm growing up and growing up during these, well, the 60s and 70s, I followed the space shuttle program, and I was very interested in Apollo. A lot of it had happened by the time I became aware of things, but all that stuff was in the public consciousness. I mean, people were aware of Apollo going to the moon and all of this stuff. It was very interesting to me. So I've always wanted to make things and make models. So as you're looking at things like this and saying, this is all stuff from the pantry, what can that be? So here's something that I made from that same stuff. So here's the drinking cup down here, the drinking straws over here, hot melt glue, and really literally this is the same box of tea here, and this is the same box on the top that goes across here. So this is just all found stuff. So my whole life I've been doing things like this. So went to college, became an art teacher. Then what do you think I was interested in? Making things with kids out of and there's another combination of poverty that occurred when I was an art teacher because I had no budget, but yet I had all of these kids. So, and they say dumpster diving. I'm a dumpster diver, and you can, that's kind of cliche, but it's actually pretty true that you find what you can find and you make what you can make out of what you find. So imagine that now moved forward, right? So my whole career I've been doing these cardboard camps where kids will make things like helicopters or airplanes, Amelia Earhart's plane. I get specific sometimes, out of cardboard. And back then it was cardboard and duct tape and plastic and 2-liter bottles that cut the top and bottom off, and you end up with this found sort of plexiglass looking stuff. And if it's Sprite, it's green, and if it's Coke, it's clear. And those can be space helmet, face shields that go up and down. And so years and years and years of this found things, creative things, and watching kids get excited by building these hands-on things. And then the more you look at space, and the more you look at space science and the stuff that we go to space in, a lot of those structures, capsules and what have you, are fairly simple shapes, actually. If you look at something like this, it's 90% already a space capsule because this is largely the shape of this. Now you've put a clothespin here, here, and here, and take a Sharpie and let kids decorate the outside. You've got a little space capsule they all get to take home, and you've got them excited, and you've got a hook in them about the Apollo program, about going back to Mars or Artemis. I mean, going to Mars or going back to the moon, and starting to talk about Artemis and what that entails. And so, it doesn't take much, right? To start, and you don't have to have $1 million to build $1 million worth of interest in kids' minds. So, with that in mind, I have made everything you can imagine from from planetariums with and that clear, it's clear, semi-clear, opaque landscaping plastic that you can buy at Lowe's or Home Depot or wherever. And if you take that and tape it together into a sphere or a hemisphere and put a house fan on the side and turn it on, it inflates and kids can go inside. And now you've got this sort of learning environment that kids can look in. And ever since I was little, I always liked going in the moonwalk. I always liked to go inside things, and kids always like to go inside cardboard boxes. So there is this thing, this natural thing that happens when you create a sort of a learning environment or an environment that kids can go into, manipulate, play it, pretend in. So all this together, cardboard and plastic and duct tape and packing tape and now make-do screws and make-do tools, the things that you can make aren't nearly endless. So with this propagation of screen time and kids sort of looking at this and sort of, I would say, subsisting off of other people's creation, right? And that's my worry, is that if that's all we're doing, if all we're doing is plagiarizing and shoplifting other people's ideas and entertaining ourselves in some sort of brave new world, you know, video wall way, what are we? So to me, there's got to be a balance here, right? So why do I like cardboard, and why do I like these big things? Because they are not screens. Now, is there a role for screens and research and AI? Probably. But it's not the role. It's part of it, right? But this idea of having a tradigital life, traditional and digital, and digital has a place in there. But if all we're going to become is these avatars in the middle of some kind of an AI construct, I don't like that future. I don't like where that's going. And if that makes me an old man or a Luddite, or so be it, so be it. But to this end, what I want to do is build things that get kids excited about the future, about what they can do, about using their imaginations, about engineering, thinking, creativity, creating, all of that. And I'd like to do that in a compressed amount of time, so 5 days or 2 days or 1 day. So I've been playing around the edges of this, and anyone who follows me knows I'm always putting out these templates, how to build your own space capsule, this 4 foot tall that a kid can have in their room, and a cardboard version of that, and then a sort of a plastic version of that, and then I have a whole website. If you go to kevinhaycutt.org and at the top click resources, you're going to find all my cardboard templates, and use all of them all you want to. What I dare you do is think bigger than that. How do we create a huge learning circumstance that involves lots of kids, lots of thinking, STEM and STEAM and research and science and building and engineering, all of those things that STEAM is, right? Art and design, all of that. So I've been playing around with ideas about that, and I finally found myself a partner out there in the world in the form of a district called Randolph Eastern School Corporation in Indiana, and working with my friend Justin, his amazing Jedi teachers who are totally open to these big ideas. I came up with this idea called Courting the Cosmos. Courting the Cosmos. So here's the idea. Yes, I want to study the cosmos. I want to get kids excited about space science and all things STEAM and STEM. But courting, what does that mean here? Well, every school has a basketball court. Almost every school. I can't think of very many that don't have a basketball court. So if you have a basketball court, you have a given size, right? A given size that a basketball court is. And that means if we move on to that court with drop cloths, right, with tarps or whatever so we don't scratch the floor, and we move in and we start building, what would that look like if we build a lunar colony in the gym? Right, so you'll see this Courting the Cosmos idea here, and then this first slide that I'm showing you here, and you can see some of the constructs that we've made, and some of these I've built, and some of these are engineered by kids as we go, but we want to connect things to things here. So so that's the idea of how what we're doing there. Now, as I move into this with these teachers, we're talking a few hundred grade school kids are going to be affected by this, but what we do is we're going to meet with teachers and mentors, and these are learning mentors, right? Not learning experts, not people who tell kids what to think or solve their problem or answer their questions, but people who ask good questions. They ask the kids, how could you find out? Where would you learn? How could you practice? Always doing that sort of question asking, not answering, right? That's the idea. And we're looking at Indiana standards, but if you look at learning standards in the area of STEM and STEAM, they're all out there and you can find them. A lot of them are going to be things like information and digital literacy. So over here, kids are doing research, right? So here's the place for those screens. It's your Chromebook or it's your iPad or whatever, but you're doing research and you're finding different ideas for lunar colonies and what NASA has to say about this. So we're trying to find out, you know, how we could build these structures and what they might look like. And so as we're engineering, we're looking at things that already exist too. We're communicating, collaborating, talking to other people in the room, working in teams, right? We're looking at the data that we're finding and we're saying, how do we build this thing? How do we make this these measurements, these numbers that we found become something that we can walk inside of and create this giant habitat on the moon inside our basketball court, right? So we're thinking, we're inquiring, we're trying to learn, we're problem solving. We have to make this thing stand with air pressure from house fans, this inflatable thing that we're building. And we're modeling first small and then bigger. And so we're doing learning application and modeling and all of these things that are part of STEM integration in Indiana and lots of other places too. So we're focused on that. But day one, what happens is high school and junior high kids come in, 30 of those kids, and they are going to be coached on how to be those learning mentors and how to ask those good questions and how to walk along and be docents to those grade school kids who are coming tomorrow into this environment. So we're going to get the environment standing. Junior high and high school is going to get the environment standing. So you'll see there's going to be this sort of main area where kids can do presentations and we can talk about things and get people together and have those sort of announcements that we send people out to build the next phase of the lunar colony. So that's sort of this big community space, and that's connected to a couple of other spaces here. And as you look at the layout here, and by the way, every one of these things might have different kinds of habitats, but if you look here, you'll see over to the side here, so here's the center thing, and over on the right you have the VOAG department comes in and they talk about how to grow stuff on the moon. How would we grow things on the moon? What are the possibilities growing things that we eat and growing plants that produce oxygen? What does that whole thing look like? So I want to bring in the VOAG teacher. I want to bring in the people who run the greenhouse in the district. And if they don't have that, when can we get that? And what can we do to simulate that until we get that? So here's this over here. Here's how we're going to live. We have a hallway that connects the main presentation area. And it inflates too, and the kids are building all of this stuff, and the bottom's going to be cardboard, and the top's going to be the landscaping plastic, and it's going to have to interface and become part of that larger communal space here. So it's going to intrude through the wall and then be taped to with packing tape so that the whole thing, when it inflates with five house fans, the hallway is now standing up, and it's 4 feet tall, and everyone can walk up and down or 5 feet tall, whatever we decide it's going to be. We, that means kids and the people who are helping. High school kids, junior high kids, adults, we're all working on the same cause. And over here now, here's this inflatable hemisphere greenhouse, and kids are going to go in there and they're going to bring in their plants, and there's going to be real learning that happens in there, right? And there's an exit there that opens up, but when it opens up, the air pressure still is maintained enough that everything doesn't deflate. What does that door look like? What does that door look like? And who engineers that door? And yes, I could engineer it. I could have experts come in and engineer it. But no, I want the kids to engineer that. They have to figure it out. Timmy's dad is in a wheelchair. He's going to need to come through here. So what's the minimum size requirements to get him through the door without the whole thing deflating? Okay, so that's just the common space plus the greenhouse. Now on the other side, you got a planetarium. And kids are going to build that. They're going to engineer that. We're going to project on the and you're going to see that there's pictures of all this stuff here. You can see where we've done this before. So everything I'm showing you here, I've done before, but usually not all in the same model. That's why I love about Randolph Eastern. They're crazy enough to do this all at one time. And this is the first one of these. I want to do these all over the world. I want to go hang out with my friend in Hong Kong and build this with his kids the way they would do it in their city. And I want to take it over to New Zealand and work with my friends over there in Christchurch and build it the way they would build it in New Zealand, and go to Australia and work with my friends in Australia and go to their school and see what that looks like in their gym. And then all over the world. Just see what this looks like, okay? So the planetarium's over here, and then we've got an airlock over there too on the end, and there's an exit there that's probably engineered in concert and collaboration with the people who engineered the one on the other side. So now we've got a communal space and a greenhouse and a planetarium, and then over the top now we've got a science lab, and the science teacher comes in and talks about the science of the moon, lunar science, and what kinds of hands-on science things can we do with elementary kids as they're coming in that day. And there's an exit on both sides, and those airlocks look like the ones down here, so we're collaborating again to build that airlock there. Then down south, and that's going south of the communal space, we've got an art lab, and we're building, making art on, what's the art of the moon? Well, people need art. What art, what role does art and creativity play in a place like the moon, where you're living in this place that's a long way from Earth, and you could be very isolated. So what is the need for art or inspiration in a place like that? What does that look like? Adjacent to the outside of this, you're going to see there's these capsules over here, these space capsules that kids are going to design. And the silver space capsules are all two-dimensional. So that's two-dimensional art that comes from the art lab and goes up here. And this is going to be the interfaces and the control panels that are all inside these three silver space capsules. Capsules that are 4 feet tall and 4 feet wide at the bottom, and four kids can work in there at the same time. Over on the other side, there's cardboard space capsules, all done in concert. I did a PDF and I made this cardboard space capsule about 4 feet tall and 4 feet wide that goes together in panels around the outside. And then I worked with a high school girl last year, Peyton, and Peyton and her teacher, Brent Kerr, of Ness City, Kansas. They came up with an amazing CAD file that could be cut out on a CNC machine. So that's what they're doing. So they make those and they ship those. So Randolph Eastern is buying three of the capsules from Ness City Schools, and a student there, Peyton, who's now a freshman in college. Amazing how, though, over at a school, I work with a student, and now that student is collaborating with this school over here, and they're working together and collaborating on this bigger project. So the kids over there working with the cardboard space capsules are adding on to and re-engineering and using make-do tools to add shelves and interfaces and functional things to these, improving, grade school kids, improving the design of a freestanding cardboard thing. So this is all engineering at the grade school level, right? But big kinds of thinking going on. So it's a long way from Kraft macaroni and cheese sandals to something like this. So am I excited? Yes, I'm excited. Now, there's more than that, okay? Kids are doing and learning in all these different places. In the meantime, there are these four quadrants, and you'll see there's a snap circuits electronics quadrant over here, right next to the cardboard spaceships, and that's on purpose because we can take all of those circuitry things and those models we make and those radios and those just everything you can do with snap circuits, and that's a lot. And we can put them in the space capsules and make them do functional things that get kids excited and parents excited, right? So that's going on. Down south of that, we're doing two blocks, and two blocks are these wonderful sort of PVC-looking colorful pipes and fitting corners and joints, and they have clips to hold it all together so kids can build lunar rovers, rebuild the lunar rover, reimagine the lunar rover. So they're down there doing hands-on engineering, and this is a lot more just hands-on engineering, not a whole lot of electronics here. So you can see that we're going all the way from digital to analog, so tri-digital, right, in that continuum. Everything is in play right now, okay? So kids are doing it over here now. Wonder Workshop, my friend Wendy Wells is coming, and she's bringing these Dash robots that kids can program using block coding. And they're going to be making probes, and they're going to be making rovers that travel around this lunar space, right? So they're learning all about robotics and stuff like that over there. And then farther down, there's a hands-on building area with smaller sort of hands-on manipulatives for little kids, preschool through third grade, and older if they want to, can build these things using NERCs. My friends designed these really cool things that go together with craft sticks. So this is the simplest of things, right? But leading to complex things that kids can be proud of. So at the end of the day, what they end up with is this amazing space. So what happens? Day two, it's all learning, and the kids are coming in on mini block as if they would go to all their specials and all their classes on their regular day, except they're coming to this learning space to learn, right, one at a time with their teachers. And the teachers are coming in and helping with this during their planning periods, and all hands on deck. All hands on deck. It's going to be amazing. Well, that night, parents and community come in, and they're going to tour this amazing lunar outpost museum, but led by the docents, and the docents are the grade school kids who learned there all day. And they're going to be showing the community what they learned and how they learned and telling them why they learned and getting them excited about, oh, they're going to own and lead their own learning. This is all happening in 2 days, in 2 days. So I'm so excited about what this could mean. But at the end of it all, we're going to leave all kinds of things with them so they have the new capacity to use all these things in the classroom. So these things that kids are excited about. So they're not gonna, we're not leaving and saying, well, that was fun. Hope you find another fun thing to do sometime. But we're leaving them with lots of stuff. And of course, we're adding a bunch of things to their list of things, their classroom resources and their learning extensions. And a lot of my friends have provided all these learning pages that I'm giving to the teachers there at Randolph Eastern, anyone else who wants to look at our created resource pages here and do something there. So I would invite you, if this is interesting to you and you'd like to bring something like this to your community, I want to talk to you about what this looks like. But in the meantime, keep watching, because you're going to see this is happening like a little over a week from now. This is happening in real time. It's going to have a few hundred excited grade school kids and some amazing mentors and high school and junior high learning mentors and community people. It's going to be amazing. So according to the cosmos, that's what's happening. And can't wait to see how this all works out. All started with Kraft macaroni and cheese. Crazy stuff, right? Thanks for watching.